So we'll start the session. Sit with your back straight. You can sit in Sukhasana or any asana of your choice. After that, going for the starting breath. Inhaling, take your arms over your head, long and straight. Your elbow will not bend when you take your arm up. And the exhalation, you have to bring it to the center of the heart. So the position of the hand, please note, please don't keep it near the chin, neither too much down. It should be somewhere in the center. Then the eyes are closed. Take an in-breath properly. सहनाववतु सहनौ भुनक्तु सह वीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावतीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ओ Take the hand straight through the center upwards. Take it and make it long first. What happens? The back becomes straight. And then while exhaling, bring your hands down sideways. Slowly you have to bring it down. Just a second. Hello, hello. Yeah, I think it's audible. Okay. So one more thing. See, have you observed singers? How many of you observed singers? When they sing songs, when there is a line and then they go to the next line, they take a breath in between two lines. You would have seen, for example, if they sing one line and then the next line comes, there is a gap. In that gap, they take an in-breath before the next line comes. So during that gap, they don't breathe through the nose. Just observe, like if they sing a song, for example, Yogena chittasya padena vacham. So that breath which comes in between is taken through mouth. Malam sharirasya. So in between, they don't take a breath like. So that's a nasal breath, right? So when you chant or when you sing a prayer, you have to, before the prayer, all those times you'll be taking nose breath only. But when new line is coming, that gap time, you have to take a good breath. And there is no time for taking a breath through the nose. If you take a nasal breath, it will be long by the time the next line will start. So they take a quick breath through the mouth. You would just observe any songs, any singer. Similarly, when you are chanting at that time, you are between the lines, not before or after. You're supposed to take an inhalation through the mouth. Then, but when you are doing Om, like Om, so before the start of the Om, it's a nasal breath. But in case after the Om, you don't have time for the next line, quick next line comes, then you take a mouth breath. Okay.
Sir, I had a question.
Yeah, tell me.
Sir, in Sirsasana, my neck bends when I do with a pillow.
The reason is you have to go slow.
Okay, sir.
So what you should do is go a little slow. Just observe. Okay, now the head, neck. There is somebody had asked this question, I think Anju or something. Okay, I'll explain that. Okay, Anju, how the neck should not bend while doing Shirshasana.
Okay, sir. Okay.
Shirshasana, see, I'll tell you one thing. See, we have seen how the normally workers, or when you see the laborers in a railway station, how they take the weight on their head, or workers, they carry the cement and the sand on their head, right, in one basket. So they take good weight, right? And how is it taking that weight? Sometimes that laborer will be taking our full bag on his head, say 50 kg, for that kind of weight is coming, right? because their neck is, one is they know the technique, how to take the weight, and their neck has is kept erect. The neck doesn't bend this side, that side, anywhere. It takes straight load. If you buckle the neck will sprain. So the way you keep your head in Shirshasana is important. That straightness of the neck will come with the positioning of the feet. So I'll explain that, you know, how that comes. So why I'm not doing it now? Can anybody tell me why I'm not showing that now?
Because we have not done loosening practice.
Good, Tanmay. That is the excellent answer. See? So that is the main point. I have not done loosening. I have not done any Surya Namaskar or something. Suddenly, if you ask me, no, can you show me headstand? I will not show. Similarly, to you also, somebody asks, you are practicing yoga for so many years. Can you show me this one? Chakrasan? Can you show me Surya Namaskar? What do you have to say? Wait. I will do it. Let me, the time has to come, no? It has the time. So first I will do loosening. So all the time you have, sit. I will show you everything. Never demonstrate anything with out of the sequence. Out of the blue, never, no, show anything to anybody. Yes, you can show, but proper procedures you have to see. Otherwise, danger. It may not happen one time. Another time when you do it, you'll get a, I know, but that's why I'm telling. Earlier when I used to take classes, no, I used to morning, early morning, 5:30 classes there. 5:30 class starts. And then during that time, suddenly I will do, you know, somebody asks, sir, I'm not able to do chakrasana. Then I will show chakrasana. At that time, okay. After some time, 10 o'clock, little, no, tightness here and there, some pain, everything is coming. The reason I did not understand in the beginning. Then, no, I used to get these repeated kind of sprains. Some day it will come, some day it will not go. The reason is without preparation, doing something. Now, especially with age. Children, okay, no, young children, their bodies, no, good flexibility is there. They can do, their body is like that. From the morning to evening, they are playing around. Their body is already, you know, active. It's not, but after you cross particular age, you have to be very careful. Observe the process, definitely. So now let us do the loosening practices. Okay, so just keep the legs in front, hands at the back. Gently shake your legs. I'm doing the same loosening which we are doing in our regular class this month. So if you're doing anything, better just loosen up a little. So you can do along with me anything that you want to ask, you can ask. I will show whatever I can. After a little time, keep the leg together. Hands are there only. There is no need to change your hands like this. It's here. Inhale and point your toes forward. Exhale, take it back, pull it back. Inhale, front. Exhale, back. Inhale, front. Exhale, back. Inhale, front. Exhale, back. One more. Inhale, front. And exhale, back. Now rotate your feet. One. All the sides. Two. Three. Those who are doing a lot with me, please do it. Four. Five. If you want to observe, no problem. One. Two. Back straight, Tanmay. Three. Don't sit like that. Never sit like that. Four. It's not going to help you. Five. Then inhaling, keep the hands side of your hips. Now your hand turns. Exhale, left leg bend, chin on the knee. Release. Right leg. Release. These are all loosening. Left leg. Release. It's in the air. Right leg. Just note it. Release. Left leg. Release. Right leg. Release. Left leg. Release. And right leg. Release. Three times each enough. Bend the left leg, catch the thigh. Where am I catching? It's not down. It's up. So I get a good grip. Then inhale, stretch the leg. Chalega itna. Bend. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, exhale. Observe my hand. Inhale, it doesn't move. And exhale. Release with an inhalation. Exhale, bend the right. Catch the thigh. Inhale, exhale. I'm gradually taking it. Inhale, exhale. Inhale, exhale. Nothing else is moving. Inhale, exhale. One more. Inhale and exhale. Inhale. hands back. Now left leg fold, cross over right thigh. Over, it's not here, so we crossed it. Catch toe, rotate ankle. One, two. See, I'm observing. Three, four, five. Ulta. One, two, three, four, five. Keep that leg Padmasana. So it was here, it came here. Hands back, flap. One. What's flapping? This thigh. Two. Breath is normal. Three. Also, don't take late lunch, 2:30, 3 o'clock lunch, and then 4 o'clock practice. What will happen? Everything will come out. Five. Catch the toe with your left hand. Inhale, stretch it forward. One. Balance here. Two. Straightness of the leg. Three. Four. Calf, hamstring, everything stretching. Five. Exhale, place it back along with the hand. Right leg fold, cross over left. Catch toe, rotate. Ankle. One. Two. Observation. Three. All the sides going. Four. Five. Change. One. Two. Three. Four. Five. Padmasana on the navel. Hands back. Flap your thigh. One. Two. Three. I'm flapping at my own speed. Four. Five. Catch the toe with the right hand. Inhale. Stretch it. Straighten it. One. Two. Hand support at the back. Three. Four. Five. Exhale. Place it down. Just closing the window. It's a little raining here. Now, fold both your legs to the ground. So, don't keep it away. Try to keep it in, little in. And so here it was like this, no? I came up like this and then flap the thigh. One. So, little pull the body up. Two. Keep flapping. Three. It's opening the groin, right? I hope you're able to feel that opening up. Four. So, gradually my calf is touching. Both the sides lift. Touching. It's not completely touching, it's just little it's happening. And five. Relax. Release the legs in front of you. Hands back, put your chin on the chest. Then neck rotation. One.
Here I have to go a little slow.
Two.
Try to
take your neck all sides. Three. Four. Five. Change. One.
Inhalation and exhalation.
Two. Three. Four.
So did you observe I consciously slowed down a little when I am doing the neck?
One more round.
Five.
That's it. Legs together, hands rowing position. Inhale. Exhale, row forward. Inhale, pull back. Exhale, front. Inhale, back. Exhale, front. Inhale. Exhale. Inhale. You should row the boat. Exhale. You take your body front and inhale. Then change. Exhale. Inhale. The hand direction changes. Exhale. Inhale. Make good circles with the hand. Exhale. Inhale. Four. One more. Five. So 5 plus 5, 10. Then spread your legs to V shape. Wide V shape. Interlock the hands in front. Take an in breath. Exhale, go to left.
till the middle exhalation. Then inhale, return. Two. Good. Three. Four. Make good circles. Five. Change. One. Two. See, I'm breathing in the sequence. Three. Four. One more. Five. 10 rounds. Then fold the legs to Sukhasana. Now you can do Padmasana if you want. So keep one leg on the other thigh. So try not to twist the knee too much. So try to keep this knee assembly a little firm so that it doesn't hurt the knee when you do Padmasana. Okay. So the knee has to be protected when you are doing Padmasana. One way to protect the knee is keeping a brick like this. If you keep a brick like this on this side, here the knees, it will take a support, it's protected because it is that height is there. If this goes down, it comes a little down, so the twist increases. So support one like this. If you find it tough, I'm telling you. If you find it very tough, both the sides you can keep bricks. Then it's very easy. So here the knees are raised, so it will not twist much. You know, those who are sitting for long durations, keep bricks like this. It will not hurt your knee. If you're sitting for a long time. This one technique. Then one leg Padmasana, arms in front. Close, spread. Close, spread. Close, spread. Close, spread. One more. Close, spread. Palm, drop. Up, down. Up, down. Up, down. Up, one more. Down. Up, close. Rotate. One, two, three, four. Big rotations. Five. Change. One, two, three. The entire wrist is rotating. Four. Five. Fold straight. Fold straight. Fold straight. Fold straight. One more. Fold straight. Fold your arm. Touch elbow. One. Where is it going? Inhalation and exhalation. Two. Up and down like that. Three. And try to look forward. Four. When your elbow goes up, is the chin going down? No. Observe my chin. Five. It's not going down. So many people are doing like this. Like this. It's going down then. The reason is the back is not erect. When the back comes up, the chest comes up, the chin will not go down. Opposite side. One. Two. Take your shoulder really back and up. Three. Four. Five. Then interlock the finger, inhale and stretch the arms to the sky. One. So just observe my side view, how the back becomes straight. You'll find it, how it changes. Like this. Really it goes up. The original backbone shape will come. So it's not like this. See? See the difference. If you sit like this, gone. It has to come up. I'm not saying that you have to arch the lordosis, need not be too much. You don't have to push your hip forward or bulge it like this. No, it's an upward stretch. Original back shape will come. Stretch it nice and full. Exhale, put the hands down. Unlock the legs in front one by one. Hands back, shake your legs. Fold your legs, one side, cat pose. Sleeping toes are better. This is standing toe, sleeping toe. Feet is apart, knees are apart, feet are apart. Hands are apart. Fingers are wide, like this, spread. Don't keep like this. Bharjari Asana, 5 times. Inhale, chin up, tail bone up.
Exhale.
Inhale.
Push the ground. Exhale.
Inhale.
Third one. Exhale.
Inhale.
You can do Jai here. Exhale.
One more. Inhale.
Stay for some time. One. So your head should go up, tailbone up, center down. Two. Three. Don't hold your breath. Four. Five.
Exhale. Round it back. One. Two. Chin close to chest. Three. Neck is high. Four. Five. Inhale, look straight. Exhale, lift your knee back. It's a little steep mountain. One. Push the ground, breathe normally here. Two. Lengthen your shoulder. Three. Four. Long back, stretching the hind legs. Five. So when you step forward, you have to look between the hands. You cannot step without looking there. So you can look between the hands, step. So one step, try to take it. That's an inhalation.
Exhale, try to fold your body.
Then inhale, stand up, hands up sideways.
Look at the thumbs.
Exhale, hands down. So that completes loosening practice. Any clarifications on loosening? Any doubts? Loosening practice? Anybody, any questions? Otherwise, we go to Chandra Namaskar. Samasthiti, front of the mat. Inhale, take the arm sideways up. Exhale, heart center. Close your eyes. Inhale again. Om. Hiranmayena patrena sat त्यस्यापि हितं मुखं तत्त्वं पूषन्न पावृणो सत्यधर्माय दृष्टये Open your eyes. Exhale, look at the nose. Now take one Ujjayi breath. First two rounds I will do with the instructions. Some important points I will tell. After that, I will do two rounds with the timer. Okay. Take one Ujjayi breath. Full. So you can observe my feet is together now. Feet cannot be separate. The first I'm explaining the first position. What is it called? Pranamasana. Ensure your feet is together, hands in heart center. It should not be like this. It should not be down also. Now don't, like children do, they do like this. Restlessness. While doing the pranamasana, they'll be doing. Because of, no, they have to do something or the other. That's the problem. So you have to slow down. That is pranamasana. Then, ekam, inhaling, stretch your arm backward. So here, what are the important points? The arms have to be parallel. You can see the parallel. So don't bend your elbow, wrist, all these things. While coming back also, some people are bending the elbow. So try not to bend your arms. Your arms should be straight and parallel, and elbow will be straight. It will be straight like this. It should not bend. It should not be making a circle like a, you know, horns of, you know, like that. Keep it straight, long and parallel when you take your arm back. Then only the body will stretch. Otherwise, the arm will do like, all the effect will go somewhere else. Knee bending, arm bending and all. Try to stretch the body upward. Then, while coming down, don't bring the head down first. That's again another one. There is my head, it's facing front. So what comes first? My head has not come. This has come first, navel. So bring like that. Last moment, bring the head inside. So it's like starting the bend from here, right? Bend from the bottom of your pelvis. Start bending from here. So bend like that. Like a wheel. And when the hand comes down, don't bring hands on the feet. It has to be parallel, like this. All right? Because it was straight, no, it came from here, no, top like that. When you reach there, bring the head into the body like that. That is second step. What are important points here? Toes together, heels together, knees together. Don't spread the knee. You can slightly bend it if you have a pain. But don't spread it. You can bend it forward if you want, not sideways. This is fine. See, I'm bending the knee slightly, right? So it doesn't hurt my back. Those who have got back pain problems, lower back problems, it's good to bend the knee slightly. Through knee. Now, when you take the leg back, it's not a short step like this. Many children do this. Not only children, adults also. Now the load on this knee is too much. The patella is taking direct load. They do only this much. So this is a mistake. You have to take this step a little longer. So from here. I've shown in some videos. Inhale. See that step? So this, you see the quadriceps? It's making an angle between the floor. It's not 90 degree perpendicular. So this step should be long. Then you get proper arch at the back. I don't have space here. That's my, this hand is bending. And what about the back toe? It is standing toe. It's not like this. It should be. So if you keep like this, you'll not lose balance easily. Yes, you may, but it will not be that easy for. Now you see here, the hip is front. Hip is front, arm is back. Like that. Elbows are bending straight. You can see a C shape here. So I'm not saying in the first round itself you should become like this. Don't do that. Initially, okay, let's tell this is fine. First round, second round and all. Then exhale, bring the hands down sideways. Chin parallel. Parallel to the ground. Pancha, inhale, other leg back. Where was my head? There only. Shut, exhale, knee, chin, chest. So, don't take support of elbow on the body. Elbow is not taking for taking body weight. Elbow will be side of the rib, not squeezing, not wider, not squeeze inside, not outside. Just on the side, it will just slide. It will just slide through the ribs. It will not take weight. The weight is taken by the arms, your shoulders, everything. So from here, where was I? I was in plank. When I go down, knee. So knee takes a little load, so it is easy for me to go down. You see, my elbow will come above the wrist. Observe that. Ashtanga. Then from here, sleep the toe. It was here, no? Sleep the toe. Inhale, bring the chin chest together. Then separate the head like that. Saw that how I came up? Exhale. Then Nava, left leg forward, inhale, hands up. Long step again. Exhale. Ekadasha. Dvadasha. So I have shown you some of the important points in all the steps. Any doubts on this? Any of the steps, any clarification? Yeah, another thing which I want to explain is how you move. It's like many people do that mistake of, you know, taking quick steps and then waiting in that position. So try not to do that. Try to start on a bell and then on a bell. Don't go fast, don't go slow. So when
hello, sir.
Yes, yes, tell me.
Sir, enikku doubt enna sir, means enikku thadi ulladondano, means enikku proper aayittu bend cheyan pattathathu ende kaalu backil endha paraya ippolum proper aayittu bend cheyan pattunnilla muttu madakkale
forward forward
ഫോർവേഡ് ബ്രണ്ട് അപ്പൊ സാറ് അതിന് എന്തെങ്കിലും ടിപ്സ് സാറിന്റെ വീഡിയോ ഞാൻ കണ്ടതാണ് ഇങ്ങനെ ഫ്രണ്ടിലേക്ക് മാക്സിമം ഫ്രണ്ടിലേക്ക് ആയിട്ട് തല താഴ്ത്താതെ അങ്ങനെയാണ് കണ്ടു പക്ഷെ എന്നാലും എന്റെ എന്താ പറയാ എന്റെ ഫോർവേഡ് ബ്രണ്ട് എന്താ പറയാ
ഇമ്പോർട്ടന്റ് ടിപ്പ് ഫോർ ദാറ്റ് ഈസ് വാട്ട് ഐ ടോൾഡ് യു ലൈക് വൺ ഓർ ടു തിങ്സ് ഇസ് ഐ ഹാവ് ടോൾഡ് ഇൻ സം ക്ലാസസ് ലൈക് ദിവ്യ ആൻഡ് ഓൾ യൂസ് ടു ആസ്ക് മീ സോ വെൻ യു ആൻഡ് ആൾ ട്രൈ ടു ഡു നോ വെൻ യു ബെൻഡ് ഫോർവേഡ് ട്രൈ ടു ബെൻഡ് വിതൗട്ട് ബെൻഡിംഗ് ദി നീ ഇറ്റ്സ് പെയിൻഫുൾ ദെൻ യു ഷുഡ് നോട്ട് ഡു ഇറ്റ് Okay. And then start bending. You don't bend downwards. Bend forward. When you bend forward, bring the body front and go. So when you do like this, right? From here you're bending. So reach front. If you reach forward, you reach forward, 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 fully forward. Forward, forward. This is enough. Now you don't see beyond this, maybe the stomach may obstruct you. It's okay. But you have taken the body front. So the problem of forward bending, most of the people is this. They do like this.
Yeah.
If you do that, see the bending has happened. Your body will round. So you have to keep the spine straight when you bend forward. The bend starts from here. Where the pelvis is there. No, this is the pelvic. No, the girdle is there. So that that full pelvis has to come forward. There is a bend here. Bend front, 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 front. So always try to do like that. I think Muttu is there. Where is Muttu? Is there? He used to, get this. When he used to practice initially, he was doing the other method. Then gradually he started changing his style. It's theory, but when you actually implement it. You'll go long, 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 long. Enough. This is enough. You don't have to bend further. Don't bend like this from here. So try to bring stomach. Reach front, front, front. Then it will come like that. Gradually, gradually, the chin will come down, 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 down. It will reach below the. body has to
foot bend daily practice edu nokki kuda correct aavan vendite
only thing is be careful because if you do too much of it then you may no if you overdo it you will get a pain at the back
so
you have to be careful don't overdo it so especially
okay,
some mild issues on the back during some other practice and all then you have to be very slow
okay sir
when the practice is going on don't do it only that
okay
would, no careful okay so try to lead the body front lead the last you have to reach like that okay that's
okay,
the
sir.
Okay now we will do
so this is Neha.
Yeah, Neha.
Unlike other asanas where I can inhale for a longer time, in mountain pose I cannot inhale for a long time. I tend to take very quick short breath. I can inhale for longer time but inhalation is very quick and very short. How much ever I try, I am unable to do it.
See, this it will come. See, aligning the breath with your synchronizing breath, it gradually improves when you practice. The more you practice it, it becomes more and more refined. Okay, that consciousness of, you know, how to, when to start your breath, when to end, that consciousness develops with time, with experience. So keep on trying, that's all what I can say. Because see what happens, I will tell you, when your body is doing some actions, the need for oxygen increases, right? When you're example, you are on a treadmill or you are doing a jogging, what happens, the body needs more oxygen and it has to remove the carbon dioxide faster. So the sympathetic nerves give the trigger to the brain that you breathe faster, you make your breath faster. So because I need, my blood needs more oxygen and I need to remove the carbon dioxide faster. So that trigger comes to the brain and brain sends signal to start breathing faster. This is what happens. So what you do when you practice is, sometimes some of the asanas are tough. When you find it tough, when you find lot of exertion or the strength of the muscles are required, and when that strength is not there in the body, you have to put a little more effort for that strength to come. That time that body needs more oxygen, so the signals will come, you will start breathing faster. So when you practice regularly, like 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 1 month, 2 months, 3 months, 6 months, gradually the body strength improves and you are also getting more conscious about your own breath. So at time passing by, the length of your breath will improve, it will and you will start inhaling slower, start, because the body will slowly develop that ability to do particular asanas with more little more effortlessness and little more power. So that gradually it will reach there. And do, so that's what in what we say, ki when we do an asana or this one, breath is a yardstick. For example, if I find that in trikona asana I'm getting breathless here, or in the down dog, which what you are telling, this is the mountain pose you're telling, right? And if you think that some of the when you reach there you are getting too difficult to breathe, so that means some of the positions you may have put little more too much of effort, by which when you reach here already are breathless ho gaya. So try to reduce the effort in those asanas where you have too much of difficulty, and then you will be able to stay here and breathe slowly.
Yes sir, this is happening in mostly in Ashtanga B. I think it's a very
that is
not it.
It will come with experience. Try to slow down your breath consciously.
Okay sir.
Yeah, with experience it will come. Okay, now I'll do with the timing. Let me do 2 rounds of Chandra Namaskara with timing. I'm keeping the timer of Chandra Namaskar. Sorry. Last round. That was Chandra Namaskara, 4 rounds. Ashtanga Surya Namaskara, 1 round I will do. So there was 1 round of Ashtanga B. So did you observe? See, when I was standing there, I was taking inhales and exhales with a little of body movement. Did you observe that? Neha and all, who was asking me, right? So why am I moving the body in that fashion? The reason is to accommodate that breath. So I'll just show that again here. So to accommodate that breath, I was making those movements. That's how you should know. So what will happen? The body will also, your lungs will also behave like that when you consciously make little movements like that. I'm not saying that you should sway front and back, not required. If you move a little, your lungs will also take that action. You can see that slight movement of the body. In this position, it's a difficult. Now, see, I'm in this extreme and I'm trying to inhale. Just observe that. It's a little difficult.
So I give a little, no, allowance for that breathing to happen. Like that. You see that?
You try to do like that, then it will be easier. You'll get that, you know, expansion and contraction of the lungs. I hope you get my point. Yeah. Any other clarifications on Surya Namaskar?
Sir, in Chandra Namaskar, the breathing control gets lost.
When?
Especially for the backward poses. Like, you know, when I take back both while being in the, you know, both the, this one, both in the sea, Yeah. So at that time, you know, I'm losing my breath control, you know, in spite of me being very conscious of it. Like, you know, I'm able to do that for 6 rounds, 8 rounds. But after that, in one of the backward poses, you know, I lose control. And from then on, it is very difficult to
get back
to the rhythm.
It's okay. See, if you find, you know, some round, it may happen. See? I think that's a matter of, you know, probably, you know, little more experience, and if you keep practicing, that consciousness will come. See, if you do regularly, I don't think gradually you'll get there. So what you can do is you stop that inhale when you find it tough. So it's an inhalation, right? So don't stretch too much, maybe a little less you can do like that. Then exhale, come back.
Okay.
It may not be not too difficult stretch. If you find it too tough, then give a little less stretch there, so that where you stop when your inhale is over. Because especially it's a backbend. Also when you do standing backbend, right, that akam inhale. So beyond a point, if you bend, you'll get locked. Your breath gets locked. You would observe that. When you do
this, both.
When you do this, take from here. Now beyond this, if I bend, the breath, you cannot inhale further. Because your chest is already locked. There is no expansion further on that. So beyond that, you should not bend also. It's not a, what do you call, standing chakrasana or something. Beyond that, you should, so match your breath till the action completes. That's it. Beyond that, don't bend too much in Surya Namaskarana. Okay?
Sure, sir.
That's over. Now there were some any questions otherwise?
Any? Sir Kishore here, sir.
Yeah, Kishore.
Sir, after finishing one round of Chandra Namaskara, can we take one extra breath?
Yes, you can do. So when you reach here in Namaskara Mudra, I have given a little time. I hope that time is quickly, you have to take one in breath or out breath. So after this, then take a quick in breath out if you want. Generally, if you're good, there's no need for it. You can take, nothing wrong in that. Take an extra breath and then start again. I call it extra breath. So ideally not required, but nothing wrong in doing that. Okay?
Yes.
If you're able to improve your other breath's performance by taking this extra breath, no problem. Go ahead.
Yes.
Yeah. There was another suggestion, like while attending class in studio, your name of the upcoming asana used to prepare my mind for the next step. Could you please do the same? I think most of the asanas I give, I tell the name, like when I do Ardhakati, then I say, some asanas are very long, Uttita Hasta Padangushta Asana. Sometimes I forget, but otherwise Marichi, I say sage posture. Yes, I'll consciously try how to mention the names, okay, before the asanas, if I can, I'll do that. There is a question about locking the anus during asanas. When to lock and when to see locking anus. See, Mula Bandha, it's called Mula Bandha, or the sphincter lock, it's called sphincter lock. So when you do particular asanas, when you stay in an asana, you're supposed to do sphincter lock or Mula Bandha. Muladhara chakra should be contracted. Where is the chakra? The chakra is between the anus and the reproductive organ. So there is a muscle between the reproductive organ and the anus, which is called the sphincter muscles. That sphincter muscle is to be pulled up. That's called Mula Bandha. So when you do that, automatically the anus also is pulled. It's difficult to do only the sphincter. So generally everything, anus lock, sphincter lock, Vajroli, the reproductive organ. All these three are pulled into the system. That must be done when you are, especially when you are doing compressing asanas. For example, say Pavanamuktasana, say any asana which you have inhaled and then you are compressing all that time. That time you should not protrude your bottom organs outward. What will happen? It will herniate. You should really leave the grip of, it can have, like problems like piles, fissures, fistula and all. If you do Pavanamuktasana without using anus lock. For example, you are doing Pavanamukta like this, When you, you come, inhale, bend the legs and hug the knees. Now exhaling, I have to bring my head up, body up. Now I'm compressing with the strength of the body. Now I inhale. So there is a pressure in the system. So if I don't have grip on the anus muscles, it will be protruded. It can herniate. So that is one main reason why the Mula Bandha must be practiced in the asanas when you stay. Because you are staying in a position and regulating the breath, and it's a difficult position to stay. That time you have to, all the asanas, most of the asanas, where when you stay in the final pose, try to lock the anus muscles. How to do that? It comes with experience. The floor of the pelvis, the floor, the bottom of the pelvis, that floor should be pulled up. You can automatically, you'll get that feeling. The anus is pulled in the body. So consciously you have to pull the anus in. So it is possible. It's called Mula Bandha. So just keep practicing. One place where you can actually learn the Mula Bandha is in Sarvangasana. When you do Sarvangasana, that time the gravity is downwards, right? The gravity is that you change the gravity of the body. So at that time it is easy to pull the anus downwards. The pelvic floor can be pulled downwards because the gravity is downwards. So while doing Sarvangasana, try to learn Mula Bandha. So it will be easy. You can replicate that learning when you're doing other asanas. Okay?
I have one question. By any chance, do we have to do Mula Bandha during the standing Udhyana Bandha and Agnisar Kriya?
There is no Mula Bandha that time.
Not required, right?
There is a bandha called Mahabandha. So some people do that. All the three people do that. Udhyana, then that your Mula Bandha, everything. But it's there in Iyengar's book and all. But while doing Udhyana Agnisara, it's not there. Some of the places, you will actually feel, this is I can do. It looks, I feel better to do it. Then that indication that you can do it there, because automatically the mind tells you. For me, I will get that sense will come in some asanas. It comes when example I am doing that Parshvakonasana, this side angle posture. When I do this asana, when I stretch, so here that length of the body asks me, so I pull the anus in. So that's where I started discovering. Okay, because that opening of the groin. The pelvis is expanded, and here I should not put the anus down. Automatically the anus sucks into the system in the Parshvakonasana. So then I started realizing, okay, then let me check. Then I your Sarvangasana, Chakrasana, all the places I started pulling it inside. Then slowly most of the asanas were barring maybe few, I don't know about that, but all these asanas keep the anus into the body. Because one way it is saving the energy, doesn't lose it. Because that is the chakra, origin. Mula Adhara Chakra is origin, right? Mula means, in temples you have heard, Mula Sthana. Mula is where the thing started. In many temples, Mula Sthana is there. Sri Mula Sthana, in your lot of places that is there. That's where, Udbhava is there, where it started from. So Mooladhara Chakra is that. So that should be preserved when you're practicing.
So sir, that should be done both while inhaling and exhaling,
While staying in the asana, yes, you have to do both times when you are inhaling, exhaling. And the moment you come to this position, no, samasthiti, see, the length comes. Automatically, the suction comes in the venous. Now, when this comes, no, what is this asana called? Dandasana, stick posture. When this erect body leg comes, automatically you can see the, you know, the suction of the anus happens. It is, you know, automatic, involuntarily it will come to me. So that was a question from, I think, Neha, right? Concept of
yeah.
Yeah. Unable to breathe maximum capacity. Yeah, I explained that how you can move your body a little here and there to get those breaths accommodated. Then I have a question from, I think Anju had asked a question. Yeah, regarding the straightness of the neck while doing headstand. So the position of the feet is important. Where you keep the leg is important when you do headstand. So from here, I inhale, come to cat, exhale, turn around. Then while inhaling, I ask you to join the knees, feet and do standing two. From here. So I have joined my knees, feet and all together. When I exhale, keep my forearm on the mat, it comes close to the knee. See that? It is not here. So I was in cat, I don't have to keep my hand in front for a headstand. Automatically it comes here. The reason is people don't observe these things. From here what they do? They do this. Automatically when you do your headstand, your leg is far away. Your neck is bending. You'll get a neck problem. Now, inhaling, I ask you to interlock the fingers and make a cup shape. Now, when this shoulder came down, elbow came down, what will be the distance between the elbow? It will be what distance? Anybody? What is the distance between the elbow?
One arm distance.
One arm distance or shoulder distance? It will be the distance of the shoulder. So that's the correct place where you keep a headstand and elbow. It should not be wider. It should be just elbow distance, I mean your shoulder distance. Exactly. And then interlock my fingers. When you keep the crown, I'm exhaling. Now, when I lift my knees up, my neck has to become straight. You have to keep the head in such a manner. See, now the weight is straight on the neck. The problem comes when you do like this or like this. So when you bring the head in and the lower neck goes front, problem. So the head comes in and the bottom of the neck goes front. That happens when the distances are not correct, if the back is not perpendicular. So keep your head in such a way that your neck doesn't, when you come up, it becomes straight. It may not be straight when you keep it. Here, it is a little bending here because the body is down backwards. But when the buttock comes above the head, then the spine becomes erect. Now it came straight, my neck came straight. You know, on a straight neck, it's very easy to take the load. See, my neck is easily taking the load. So those who are planning to learn Sheshasana, you have to first balance with folded legs. Once you are comfortable with balancing on the wall, don't do balancing from the wall, taking the leg off. That will reach you there. But more than that, try to get folded leg balancing. So once you are good with wall support, from here, you will take the knee up here, try to fold up one leg, taking the weight, fold up the other leg. Now see, the balance is obtained. If you learn this, then it's easy. Because you just have to take the leg away and then take it up. So try to learn folded leg balancing and keep the neck upright.
So the crown, this should be on the floor. So I'm not looking up because no, I should not look up suddenly.
Slowly I should look up. So I'm not looking up suddenly because the blood flow changes. So keep the center of the head, the crown on the floor. And then lift your knees up. Your hip will come above the head. Like that. And then feel the, so it should, don't keep like this. If you keep like this, now you can see my neck is bending. Neck is bending. And I'll get neck pain. Pakka neck pain. Walk forward, walk forward, walk forward. Bring the neck perpendicular. The body and your back perpendicular. Then you will not get much pain.
Am I audible to all of you?
Yes, okay. Sir.
Yes, sir.
The battery was down. Something happened to the battery. Okay. So that's the important point of headstand. Any other points on headstand? Anybody like who would ask that? Anju, yes.
Sir, appam ingane ee position la nikkuna time il nammala strain ee load full varunathu ee thalayilekkano means enikku thala vedanikkaranichu appo njan nikkunnathinte prashna irikkum.
Hello, so what you should do is before you start the this one, you keep one blanket handy for you. Like this is I have a small blanket here, right? Like this.
Okay.
So initially I'm telling, because beginners you may feel a pain on the center of the head. Is the head paining or your neck is paining?
Head ana vedanikkunnathu. Touch cheyina bhagam.
So what you have to keep, like a little thick, you know, some kind of cloth, a thick, okay, or a bed sheet folded like this, you know, into a little rectangular shape. So okay, when you keep this, now my head is soft.
Okay.
Now it's easy. It doesn't pain much. Okay, like this. And I am asking you to stay for 5 breaths, right?
Yes.
So if you find it's tough, after 3 breaths, you just exhale, put the knee down. Like that. Inhale, sleep the toe. And exhale, sit back. Like that, okay. If you find 5 breaths are tough, you can come back on 3 breaths.
Okay, sir. Thank you.
Something like this, you know, close to your mat so that the time when your Shishasana comes, keep this.
Okay.
And keep it, you know, this is fine. It's better to keep the entire leg because your elbow also will not pain.
Okay.
Yeah. And so neck pain will come if you don't keep the neck straight. That is, you have to be careful. Okay. But when you headstand, generally neck pain doesn't come unless you take a wrong position of the leg. So just be careful while keeping the leg.
Okay, sir.
Any other queries regarding headstand or whatever we spoke about? Just observing who are all there, Gopi is there. Some of the, like Gopi in your case, I think when you take the arm back, when you stretch your arm back in Surya Namaskar, right? That time I find till you reach there, you're good. But somewhere, I think some circle happens in your hand, somewhere. So try to be a little conscious. I don't know where it happens. Somewhere when you do that in Surya Namaskar or Chandra Namaskar, when you exhale, come forward, somewhere there some turning happens. Try to correct it. Okay. One thing I observed. Other in Jyoti's, this one, what I have observed is that going into that Ashtanga Namaskara, no? That here, from the plank, when you go down here. So keep the knee down. Don't confuse that time. First put the knee down. Don't try to bring the upper body down first, because you may find it tough. So from here, I know it's a little difficult for you, maybe the strength is you have to develop. So try to bring the chest in front. Like that. I know this, you know, upper body, all the shoulders will take a weight while doing that. So try to gradually get there. You have improved, so just put a little more focus on that. And don't try to squeeze the elbow into the body and take the weight. Like, don't do this. When you do this,
See, I'm doing that now. I'm just squeezing my elbow inward and taking the weight on the bone so that I can easily go down. If you do that, your shoulders and your elbows may get injured. So some children also do this in the class. I don't know if anybody is there. So they take the weight on the elbow and then go. See, now it's taking elbow weight. What will happen? My shoulders will go, it will get damaged. Because the muscle is supposed to act during that time. Don't take the weight on the bones. Yeah? Joints will get damaged. Initially it will not happen, but when you keep on. So it's okay. Do what you can. If you find it tough, just lie down in the beginning. Gradually the strength will come. Okay. Another thing. In case of Tanmay, see now also you are sitting on the camera. So these are things you have to correct. You have to go back, really back, Tanmay. You go away from, see the screen sitting too close to the camera is not good. Because it has got radiation, no? Your eyes also, at your age, you're young boy. So it will damage your eyes if you sit close to the screens. And always the best way to sit is Vajrasana. Because if you sit Sukhasana like this, the body will bend. Your spine is already bent like this. So try to correct your posture. If you sit in Vajrasana, the body straightness will come. Keep the body erect. Okay, always when you sit. That's what I have to tell you, Tanmay. Otherwise, discipline and all, if you can improve, that you have to improve. In Muthu, in that, what I've observed is, when you do the loosening, so here itself, you are keeping the hand like this. It's not required initially. When you do this, inhaling, exhaling, then rotating the feet. So because it's a little long process, now by that time your back may get tired. So initially, when you do the pointing toe, pointing back rotation, your palm hand can be facing backside. And when that bending the leg comes, inhale, then exhale. That time you can turn your hand and get ready. So that's one suggestion that I observed, Muthu. It's okay, right?
Okay. Yeah.
Okay, if you feel this way, but this is a better way to do it. Anita Raghavan, what I've observed in... some of the rounds you're doing Ashtanga Namaskara, and some rounds you're doing Chaturanga Dandasana. So is it as per your own planning, Anita, or is it?
Yeah. So when I lose strength, I try to do Ashtanga. When I'm able to do it, I try to do Chaturanga. So I plan in my mind that I am going to do Chaturanga and I try to push myself. I'm trying to do Chaturanga, but it's not very easy for me.
Fantastic. If it's planned, then no problem. That is perfect yoga only. Don't worry. So I thought it was due to, not aware. So you're aware, no problem. No questions, nothing required. That is what you should know. Every person should do. Okay, now I've seen Shanbag, Preeti doing that. First, I think three rounds or something, she will do stepping. And I think fourth, fifth, she start hopping. Preeti, right? Correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Earlier, I used to do all the rounds, but then, I don't know, eventually I just lost complete strength. So then I just, first I started with only four rounds. Now, slowly I've increased it to five rounds of hopping. So yeah, eventually I want to do all the rounds. That's the plan.
So that's what she has planned her practice. So that's what you should know. We should plan. So that gives a lot of focus in the mind. Okay, that means I'm in control of what I'm doing. So that is what we should learn. We have to pick up the examples from people like them, so that we do the planning properly, and then we practice as per our own preparation. Then Kishore, right? In some asanas, I find the getting doubled. I don't know which asanas. I think Marichi asana or some asana where after that, I think Ardha Matsyendra asana. So when you do the final exhalation, so then I'm supposed to inhale and look forward. So one of the asanas where somewhere I find a breath lost, and then you again take an exhalation, then again inhalation comes. So I think you can correct that. Kishore, are you there?
Yes, sir, I'm there. Got it.
I think I don't remember which asana. Somewhere I found like no some asanas. So maybe is it if it's consciously happening, no issue. If you're taking an extra breath, so just try to correct that. This one that no.
Okay.
Then Anju, yeah, Anju. Another thing that I've noticed is no. Once the instruction is given or it has already started, then you're in Surya Namaskara especially, mostly Surya Namaskara and some asanas. Then after the instructions is started, then you start the, you know, step. So by that time, I think that, no, the breath or the time is over and remaining you will have little, you know, less time for taking that action. So mostly because maybe you're not clear about the next step. So maybe you can correct your, I mean, just do a little, you know, which comes with experience, try to learn the steps for an asana or, for example, when I'm doing, I'm going to just show you an asana, maybe I'll show you Adhomukhi Virasana. Just observe how I do. I'll go a little back so that I'm visible. Now, see, the timing for an asana is exactly as much it is required. It is not, there is no extra time because it's a flowing class. It's not, no, I'm not finding fault, okay? This is not a class where I'm finding fault with people. I'm just looking for opportunities of improvement. I also make many mistakes. Don't worry about what, you know, mistakes. I'm just finding corrections, okay? Now, observe when I am starting the action. I'll take one more breath. So if you notice, each step there are, I think, 4 seconds. There are 4 seconds, right? And that 4 seconds are meant for taking that action, taking that inhalation, and completing that action within that 4 seconds, right?
Yes, sir.
So I inhale and I spread my knees and be ready for the next step. 4 seconds. Then exhale and bend forward. So the time I have given is only for that exhalation and action.
Yes, sir.
Now, I'm not talking only about you. What happens generally is, now I don't know the first step itself. Okay, now ekam, inhale, spread the knees apart, mat distance. So ekam, inhale, knees apart. By the time that instruction is heard, that is the time when we start action. Okay, to inhale, I have to spread the knees apart. Now how much time is remaining? Only 1 second or 2 seconds. So my action will be tuck. Or it will be overlapping with the next step. Now if I don't know that next step is an exhalation and that I have to keep my forearm on the mat, the 2 seconds will be lost in realizing that this is the next step, correct? So the remaining time is very less. So what happens automatically, this happens in beginners, like no first 2-3 weeks or a month. More than that, you should be able to pick up these things, okay? So I'm just giving this thing that try to learn these steps so that when the bell comes, I start my action. Like now, if I talk about, say, Sridhar, Muthu, all these people, or Shanbhai and all, they know what is it. Say Shilin is there. Who else is there? Yeah, some of you. I'm not taking names. So just to give an example. So try to learn the sequences in such a way that I don't look at my screen always. I prepare in advance. Okay, so your flow will be good. Your breath will be nice. The steps will be in a nice flowing action. Okay, so try to go with the timing. That's what I want to tell Anju. Okay.
Sir, I have a question on Romukha Virasan.
Yeah.
Sir, in this, in the final pose also, the buttocks are touching the heel?
Yes. In this position also, buttocks is touching the heel. It's touching the heel.
Okay.
It's not lifted. At the same time, the chest will be touching the floor. If you find it, you can put forehead or chin. I find chin easy. I mean, chin more nice and long. Because my chest is touching. If your chest is not touching, and if you try to keep the chin, then your neck will pain. In that event, you can keep the crown on your forehead down. I think your chest is touching. Most of the people, the chest may touch. Okay. Some people, it may not touch. Don't worry. In that time, you can rest your forehead instead of the chin. Yeah. Somebody's on unmute. Okay. So that's what I had to ask. Then, Shilin, I think Chakrasana you are not doing. So I that is with as per your own plan only. And this, I mean, I have now found that you are able to do that. This one, Pillar Setubandha, right? That Pillar Setubandha you are able to do well. I mean, at least you have started doing that. That is also fine. So I'll show you today that asana. Can you mute Anju? So Shilin, you are doing as per your plan only, no? The Chakrasana you are not doing.
Yeah, correct.
So you find it difficult or no, is there a pain?
I find it very difficult to do it. So,
is there a pain on your back or shoulder and something like that?
It's a pain on the shoulder. I'm not able to lift it up. So that's the issue.
Okay, no problem. So now today I'll show you that when others do Chakrasana, there are some people who are not doing Chakrasana. So like that, now Shilin is doing that your Pillar Setubandha. It's called Setubandha Sarvangasana. So I'll show you today. I think Tanmay is also making a mistake on that. How to do that Setubandha Sarvangasana, I want to show you today. So just observe the techniques of doing that. This is a simple technique. So I think my picture is... view is not correct. Okay. So I go to Samasthiti. I think I'll keep my mic outside. Ekam. Exhale. That's also Ekam. Dui is an inhalation. One. Two. Three breaths are over. First exhale, I have to put my first pillar. So from here. So did you observe what I did? Keeping the grip of this ankle grip, I lifted my this side of the hip, and inserted the pillar. Observe it. See, I lifted my shoulder, brought this hand. So now, then I climb on this pillar. Did you see that? See, my hip height was not enough in the beginning. So what I did is, I lifted this shoulder little up, brought this pillar, and then climbed on that pillar. And what did I do? I lifted the other shoulder. So that this was done with exhalation. This is done with inhalation. The second pillar I brought below. And then, now you see my both the pillars are really inside. The full weight is on the hand only. Then I exhale and just walk. Now see that arch of the back.
Now there is no way for the pillar to slip. It cannot slip only because the elbows are really inside. When I do this, the arch builds and your chakrasana becomes very easy. I want to show it once again. Then inhale, walk back, exhale and release. Okay. Now I want to show you that technique once again if you want to observe it. That's a good way to get that Setubandha Savanasana. Inhale. Finish that inhalation. Exhale. Inhale. Exhale. You can form the arch, real arch, with your pillar Setubandha. The effect of this asana is as good as your chakra. Okay, we are trying to put this in the next month, in the next month sequence. Let us see how many of you can do it. Then inhale, walk back. Exhale. Inhale, leg out. Exhale. So did you get that? No, the technique. Try to follow that.
Yeah, got it.
Yes.
Thank you.
Have a nice.
Thanks. Tanmay also.
Yes, sir, I have a question.
Yeah.
Sir, in chakrasana, what to focus? A good breathing or the final posture? Because I know I can do the chakrasana. Final posture, I can get it. But when I go to the final posture, I need to compromise on the breathing.
Priority breath. Always priority breathing. Now, why the, see, the intensity of arch, are you doing too much of it? Then your breath gets compromised.
Yes. When I do too much, then breath get compromised.
So you don't push too high. After you focus on the breath, two, three weeks, gradually your breath will become more refined. And then you can improve, no? You can improve the height gradually. Priorities for breath. Then looking. Final priorities for the posture. Okay.
Okay.
Sir, what do you think about using a yoga wheel to improve this back bend?
Try. That's a, yeah. There are, or you can lie on the wheel. So you can try. So it will improve your back bending. In our studio, we have that, back bench is there. On the bench, we lie down. So now the studios are closed. So no way. So generally, if you lie down on the wheel carefully, okay, all these props have got benefits and they are risky also, because props are external device which can help you to achieve some postures, which can reduce pain in some cases and which can intensify the asanas in some cases. So you have to use carefully so that you don't get hurt. Okay, just when you lie down, ensure that you don't do too much of it so that and your back hurts. Just be careful when you're doing that. These are good practice, good techniques to improve your back bending. Yoga wheels.
Sir, I observed while doing this, the body comes down.
Which one? Chakrasana?
No, sir. What you showed.
That is because you're not inserting the pillar properly. And you're looking sideways and all. So try to insert the pillar really below. Both the elbows should be as close as possible. So the pillars, you cannot keep pillar like this, no? What will happen if you, in your house, in your building, you keep pillar like this? It will fall down, no? Pillar cannot take load like this. Pillar will be straight. It has to be from the bottom, you have to support, really. So you get proper support, you get, good, this one.
I have a question. So this was on Marichi A. It's a small question only. So after taking the binding and then bending forward, I see that the leg that has been stretched in front, right? If I turn it slightly outward, then I'm able to bend better as compared to keeping it straight. So, but the actual asana is that you don't turn the leg, right? It needs to be straight only, correct? Or is there a turn that happens?
No, turn actually sideways. Be careful, because if you turn it, maybe your joint should not get weak. I mean, twisted.
Okay.
All it is done with that, with the keeping this leg straight only. To try not to incline it. So when you incline it, I think maybe sometimes the knee may twist or something. Just be careful on that.
Just try to do what you can without, you know, dropping. Don't open your right foot.
Okay. Sir, Sridhar here. When I do that Setu Bandhasana with the pillar, right? For easy, what I do is I lift the heels and then bring my hands in. So that gives extra height so that we can keep our hands in.
Yeah, that's also a good idea. I was lifting my shoulder, right? So instead of that, you can try also lifting the heels and bring the pillars below the body. So that once you get the pillar, so it's like your I think Neha or somebody said, no, yoga wheel. So this is also a kind of prop. It's a support, no? It's a pillar of with your own body part. And you get, so if you get that height by lifting the heels, like Sridhar said, you can support your hand and then you can extend your legs forward. This asana is going to come next month. We are planning to do that. So ensure that, no, you get that technique of lifting that shoulder and the heel and inserting, then inserting. So it may be tough for some people. If you find it tough, you may, no.
So that can be done, right? By lifting the heels and then inserting and then give the support and roll on your shoulders.
It can be done, definitely.
Yeah. Yeah. That is how I get the height to insert it.
Yeah. Any other questions? Otherwise, I'll speak a little about pranayama also. Another 15 minutes we have, right?
So, yeah, one question. I'm forgetting the exact name. Padangushtasana in the supine posture. It's called Supta Padangushtasana.
Right? Yeah.
So, in that, when we split our legs, where do you feel the strain on the inner side of the leg? Because I feel the strain on the knee, on one of the knees, right? On the left knee, I feel a slight strain over there. So I'm feeling like probably I'm doing something wrong.
Normally,
I'm not able to widen the legs more.
The pull doesn't come on the knee ideally. So it comes on the abductors, the inner part of your thigh. Yeah, it doesn't come at all on the knee.
Okay.
It comes entirely here, the length between the knee and the groins. That part pulling. Maybe a little difficulty somewhere on left knee, right?
Yeah. So was there a slight bend when you were...
It's not, because see, our arm is shorter than the leg, right? The arm is definitely shorter than the leg.
Mm-hmm.
It definitely goes towards the head side. It cannot be exactly on this. So it will be a little towards that side. Even if when you do that one leg Supta Padangushtasana, this one, this leg. So this leg comes a little angular, right? It goes to the shoulder leg. Similarly, here also it opens up a little. Still towards the upper, towards the shoulder side.
Right.
Okay. I should take my hips up this way. I'm sure you're not doing that. So try to keep the hip down, towards the ground.
Okay.
Don't allow the hip to lift up. But your hand will reach long and try to open up as low as possible.
Okay.
I think maybe little tightness on the knee somewhere, it's causing that. Yeah, yes. Ideally, it should not cause.
Okay, sir. I'll watch that. Yeah.
Then, so I'll speak a little about pranayam. So, any other questions on any asanas? Nobody, right? So, what is the first pranayama that we do? Kapala Bhati pranayama. Kapala, skull, Bhati, shine, pranayama, extended breathing or prolonged breathing. So, some people what you can do is, I am taking all the 11 rounds in one set, one length, right? So, if you may find a little difficulty, some of you, continuing all the 11 rounds. So, it's okay to take a break, you can skip the fourth round and the eighth round. Two rounds you can skip. So then 5th to 7, 5, 6, 7, 8 drop, 9, 10, 11. 1, 2, 3, 4 drop. 5, 6, 7, 8 drop. 9, 10, 11. Like that you can do if you find it tough. The other method you can do is start mild. So initially like this. Like
this much only. See, the strokes are mild. That much only. See, now Tanmay, you're moving body. I don't know what is this. But see, don't learn these wrong things. Now, what will happen? You'll spoil the whole spine. You're doing like this and all. See, all these you have to come out of it. I'm just observing you. You have to get rid of all these. No, you should not move your body like it's a stomach abdominal breathing. Only the abdomen moves like. See my side view. If you keep the hand, it can be visible. That's all Kapalbhati. And between each exhalation, there is an inhalation. It's not only exhalation. So, you may not be able to hear my in-breaths. Exhale is more audible. So, after 4-5 rounds, gradually make it stronger. The strokes, like this. Now you can see the sound has increased. Still the body doesn't move. Shoulders and chest is not moving. The strokes have become stronger. So by the time you cross 7th, 8th, gradually make the strokes stronger. And the deeper the strokes, the better the effects. So you have to choose how much you want to give strokes. So as an experienced practitioner, I may give stronger strokes, but you may not be able to do it, somebody. So it's your choice how much you want to do. You can go continuously all the 11 rounds mild also, like perfectly fine. Okay, so this is what you have to practice. So in Kapalabhati, and ensure some people they are doing ulta, so never do that. Like the stomach goes in while inhaling, like how is that possible? I'm not able to understand only how you can inhale when the stomach goes in. So they never do that. It will only spoil your systems. Okay, so don't think about it. If you are doing correctly, just forget about it. Okay, so don't do ulta. The stomach goes in while exhaling only. So try to practice like that, Kapalabhati.
A question here in this Kapalabhati.
Yeah.
So when we are doing it, that exhalation happens through our navel when we exhalation happens, right? So
yeah.
Even the nostril, we need to give the force to exhale, or just only the stomach? Because I am using only the stomach to exhale, but nostril force is not being given.
No, not required. That's not required. Automatically. There is no. Correct. Yeah, it's a. The forceful exhalation happens with the abdomen only. That's all. There is no action on the nose here.
Okay. Okay. Because when we say that Kapalabhati, even that head and that nostril comes into play, so we are not using that, right? Only the stomach we are using it.
That's all.
Okay.
I have Thank seen you. Some classes they do with the, with the... No, I don't have like that. So that's not, we'll not do like that. Not
because really. When you're doing it, I'm able to see that force coming through your nostril also, even the sound which it passes through your nostril. That doesn't happen to me. Only the stomach when I press it.
Mike, no, I little increases this.
Okay. Not like so that. Nothing wrong in what I'm doing?
Nothing wrong. Correct one.
Okay.
That's all.
Okay.
The automatic. Natural resistance in the nose, nostrils.
Okay, so no force exerted through our nose.
Yeah.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Don't move your back. Then when you're moving the back, you're doing like this. As if you're sitting on some horse or something. Eh? So doing horse riding. Don't do that. All that
will damage your backbone.
He's not able to realize. So first you have to realize, what is happening. You have to think, what should I do? You should not do something just out of the blue. You have to think, what am I doing? Am I breathing with stomach? You have to think 10 times before doing what you're going to do.
don't learn the long techniques. I told you it's just a stomach breath. You just focus only on the abdomen. That's all you need to clear your mind, clear the blackboard. Just wipe everything off. You say, okay, say to yourself, I will breathe with my stomach. I will not, you know, run my back, strike my back here and there. Never do all those things.
Then, Ujjayi Pranayama. Ujjayi. So, what we are doing is 8-6-8-4. I hope all of you are able to follow the timing. Or do you find it very tough doing that sequence of 8-second inhalation, 6-second holding, 8-second exhale, 4-second holding? Anybody finding it very tough?
Sir, for me, inhalation is tough for 8 seconds, sir, but exhalation is okay and holding is okay.
Oh, so inhalation, 8 is tough for you?
Yeah.
Anita?
Yeah.
Maybe because, are you doing the bandha, the Uddhyana bandha after exhaling, seconds of holding, are you sucking the navel inside?
Yes,
I am. So maybe, you know, then it's a case of, are you in, see, generally the breathlessness comes when your inhale is not complete and deep. If you have not inflated the lungs in three directions, all the three dimensions, the oxygen level, you know, may not be good enough. And when you exhale, suddenly the oxygen level drops. And then suddenly you are asked to pull up again. So maybe just observe. So what I do generally is, when I put my chin down, once or twice, I look at my own body to check that the expansion comes up. Now, some people, I'm not talking about you. I'm just talking generally. When you inhale, the first stomach comes, then the circumference increase and the chest bulges. It bulges up and a little front and a little up like that. So when I inhale, did you see the chest came front and a little up? It came a little up also. So that high, that three, so it has to go three dimensions, right? In Vibhagya Shvasana, we do stomach breathing, thoracic breathing, and clavicular breathing. All the three breaths are included in a yogic breath. So it's not that everything remains only downwards. Deep breathing generally, it is said as diaphragmatic breathing. But when you do a yogic breath, we are supposed to expand in all the three directions. Deep, wide and up. It should not be like, it's not that, no, I bring my neck up and shoulder up, not that. The chest will bulge sideways and a little up so that the circumference of the chest increases. Try to get that, no, three dimensions, complete inhalation. So you can see the height of the chest, little it came up. So try to get this dimension of inhalation. Then when you get that deep in breath, then the oxygen levels will also be high and the bahya kumbhaka, external retention, will become easier because the in breath was good.
Okay.
Yeah. Try to, I think, see, now in my advanced class, you can ask Preeti. We were doing 8 second inhale, 8 second holding, 8 second exhale, and 8 second holding. Now I'm going to show you one cycle of a 12 second holding. Okay, just see how I'm going to 12. I do 16 also, 16 second holding. I'm going to show you 12, 12, 12, 12. I'll keep my own sound instead of that sound. Wait, I think my mic is off. After this, I'll disconnect because the other class will start. I'll just show you one cycle. I do 8 cycles of this. Down.
Inhale. Retain. Exhale. exhale. Sustain. Inhale. Retain. Exhale. Sustain. Retain. Exhale. Sustain. Retain. Exhale. Sustain. Inhale.
So, do you observe the timing that I was using? It was 12, 12, 12, 12. So, I can do this another 5-10 minutes. I can continue this without any difficulty. So, that comes, you know, with the right technique. If you lose the energy in the wrong place, all that is a problem. Okay. So, I was just demonstrating how to gradually. Now, this. When I do with my fingers, I do 16, 16, 16, 16. 16 second inhale, 16 hold, 16 exhale, 16 Bahya Kumbhaka. But that I can do 4 rounds. Beyond that, I don't do. Because it's little more difficult. So I don't do beyond that. So this is all with, you know, with experience it will come. With control, with mind presence. Okay. With that, we close. I think it's time up. The other class will start now. Okay. Thank you. Inhale. And exhale. Okay, thank you for joining all of you. Namaste. Take care. Bye bye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye.
Bye, sir. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Bye.